Hi guys, thanks for tuning in to another video on ForgottenWeapons.com. I'm Ian McCollum, and today we're talking about a prototype French assault rifle slash submachine gun, the Fusil Automatique 1918, the automatic rifle model of 1918. This was designed by a guy named Paul Ribeyrolles, or as it would be spelled in English, Ribeyrolles. He was actually the manager of the Gladiator bicycle factory, and became something of an arms design expert himself over the course of being heavily involved in the design of the 1915 Chauchat, or CSRG. The R in that name is for Ribeyrolles, and the G is for Gladiator, his factory where the guns were built. He was also involved in the RSC 1917-1918 guns. Again, the R is Ribeyrolles. And so he was involved in arms design, and in particular in some of the most advanced forward-looking arms design that the French military was doing during World War I. And the 1918 automatic rifle, or automatic carbine, some sources call it, was definitely on this forefront. It was a select-fire, intermediate cartridge, magazine-fed short carbine. In concept, one of the very first weapons to embody this role of the assault rifle. Now, it wasn't the very first. In addition to some experimental ones that I may not be thinking of, there was also actually an American weapon, which we did a video on, a 1917 Burton rifle that fulfilled all of these roles and actually had more than a few similarities to the 1918 Ribeyrolles that came a year before. Burton was 1917. But the reason that people are aware of this 1918 French firearm is because it was added into the video game Battlefield 1. It's in there, and a lot of people are wondering, well, what's the deal? Where are they? People would like to see one. Unfortunately, to the best of my knowledge, there are no surviving examples, and there's basically only one existing photograph of the gun, and it's this. So overall, this thing was 1.09 meters long. That's about 43 inches, which means it is just about the same size as an Indochina pattern Berthier, except it would have had a magazine right about here in the middle. And one of the big things about this particular rifle is that it was heavy. So the thing weighed 5.1 kilograms. That's 11 and a quarter pounds. Think of this kind of like a Thompson, except longer. That's a really heavy gun. And for an infantry sort of shoulder weapon. The reason it was that heavy is that it was a simple blowback action, and it was chambered for either 8x35 or 8x32 semi-rimmed. Different sources give different numbers. That cartridge was basically the 351 Winchester self-loading cartridge, which the French used in the Winchester 1907 rifles during the war. They basically took that cartridge, gave it a semi-rim, so a little bit wider, a rim that was a little bit wider in diameter than the cartridge body, to presumably to get better extraction, although that would also probably hinder its feeding in magazines. Anyway, they took that cartridge case, they sized the neck to .32 caliber or 8mm, and used an armor-piercing 8mm Lebel rifle projectile in it. All of this seems pretty slick and pretty forward-thinking. It really was an intermediate power cartridge. The simple blowback action means it had to have a pretty darn heavy bolt in order to handle that cartridge. Typically, when we look at intermediate cartridge weapons like AR-15, AKs, the German Sturmgewehr, all of these guns have locked breech actions, and they're still fairly heavy. The Ribeyrolles had just a simple blowback like a submachine gun. It used a 25-round magazine, and it was actually first introduced in the summer of 1918, where it was tested at Versailles. Ribeyrolles presented this to the French military for their testing, and unfortunately, the testing went really pretty poorly. The gun had significant reliability issues. If I'm reading it right, the one piece of data I saw said that they tried firing 75 rounds in semi-auto and they had 53 malfunctions. So not quite there in 1918. And then, of course, the war ended in November of 1918 before the gun had a chance to be developed and perfected anymore. Now, it did come back after the end of the war, and in 1921, Ribeyrolles presented it again for further testing in the summer of 1921 at Camp de Chalon, and it didn't apparently really do much better. And what this, even if it had worked perfectly at that point, it was it was honestly too far ahead of its time to be adopted at that point. The French military was trying to fit this into an existing one of the roles that they had in mind for small arms. And so what they were picturing was an infantry rifle and like an individual weapon, which would have been something like a submachine gun, looking at the German MP18 sort of concept. And the problem they had was that this Ribeyrolles 1918, it was too heavy to be a submachine gun. At 11.25 pounds, it was too much and they didn't think it fit that role. It was also too underpowered as an intermediate cartridge to fill the role of an infantry rifle. They found that its effective range pretty much ended at 400 meters. And remember, this is still in the day of we want 800,000 meter effective range. The French would eventually go on, actually what they would adopt fairly shortly after this was the 7.5 by 54 millimeter rifle cartridge, which is just slightly less powerful than 7.62 NATO. And obviously that's what they were looking for, not an intermediate cartridge. On the one hand, you could look at this as being a huge oversight and a missed opportunity to really get the jump on small arms technology again. On the other hand, it's worth considering that they almost certainly wanted one cartridge to use in both machine guns and rifles, and something like an intermediate cartridge like 8x32 or 8x35 semi-rimmed was not an effective machine gun cartridge. And so that's justification to reject it. Now, should they have used it? Yeah, probably, if the gun had worked reliably. And again, it's important to point out that it didn't. In fact, as best I can tell, they only ever made a grand total of 3,000 rounds of ammunition for the thing. I don't know how many actual examples of the gun were made, but it certainly was not many. As far as I know, none of them survive to this day. So that is why I am doing this discussion of this gun here in my chair instead of waiting to actually bring you one from a museum, because I'm pretty sure I'm never actually going to find one because I don't think any of them exist. So that is the story of the Fusil Automatique 1918 Ribeyrolles. Hopefully you guys enjoyed it. If you enjoy using it in Battlefield 1, awesome. Yeah, it's worth being aware that in video games, they don't ever have malfunctions, and that was the primary downfall of this particular weapon in reality. Well, thanks for watching. Tune in again tomorrow for another Forgotten Weapon.